Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions About Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. And this week it's our August special subject, The Silent Naruse. Four films from the early 1930s, Flunky Work Hard, No Blood Relation, Every Night Dreams, and Apart From You. Later on, stay tuned for Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto. We'll be talking about our viewing experience at the AMC Cinema watching Barbie. But now, let us get into Mikio Naruse's silent films.
So these were released by the Criterion Collection in 2011. Dave Kerr reviewed it for the New York Times. He was not impressed. He thought it was a bad idea to release these before almost any other Naruse films were available. For his mature work was available. At that time, only When a Woman Ascends the Stairs was available in the United States.
Well, that's fair enough.
It is, but I have to take issue with his very lukewarm response to these films themselves. In the article.
Oh, I agree. I thought they were a great set. Well, none of them is perhaps as great as Sound of the Mountain. There's some really incredible stuff in here that I'm looking forward to talking about.
So Naruse was up until the early 2000s, like around the time this Senses of Cinema article on him by Frida Freiberg was written, was considered the neglected great Japanese post-war director. And in this article, she goes into some of the reasons why that might be. He just didn't fit the American conception of what Japanese film ought to be. What she focuses on in this article is his socioeconomic materialism. In fact, it's called The Materialist Ethic of Mikio Naruse. She talks about how his characters battle to satisfy basic physical, social, and economic needs. So right there, you can see how this is already the case in these silent films. And this is something that distinguishes him from Ozu, who he got unfavorably compared to a lot because they were both making domestic dramas, realist contemporary domestic dramas, often focusing on women.
Right. But as you say, there is a very different emphasis, despite the fact that the socioeconomic milieu might be quite similar.
In some cases, obviously not in all of these geisha films. Working geisha, the way you talk about a working actor. Geishas who never made it.
Well, they don't become celebrated all-time great geishas, is that what you're saying? Sure.
Another reason he got compared to Ozu is that initially they were both working at Shoshiko Studio, and that's the studio where he made all of these films, but he later moved to Toho.
Right.
And that's where he made the films that he is known for. We did see two of these already for the Toronto Silent Film Festival this year, and we talked about them in Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto.
Yeah.
So those were Flunky, Work Hard, and Apart From You. And I guess we'll discuss these films in the order we watched them.
Yeah.
Where those two were bookending the viewing experience, although Apart From You was released a few months before Every Night Dreams, in fact.
Okay.
I wasn't blown away by them when we saw them for the Silent Film Festival, but now having seen even just a couple more of his silent films, and also thinking about this Senses of Cinema article that I read going into it, I feel more of a sense of who he was as a sort of juvenile auteur, and that definitely enriched the viewing experience. He did make these in his late 20s, so that's pretty young for a director. It's fair to talk about them as juvenilia.
And certainly the most juvenile of them is our first film, Flunky Work Hard, which is a short. It's not a feature-length film. It's less than half an hour, and it's got a, fair to say, an uneven tone to it, which is, I think, by design, but still a little jarring.
I like this okay on a first viewing. On a second viewing, I think I realized how much I like it. I actually like it quite a bit, and I love the lead actor.
Yeah, he's pretty interesting. It introduces a lot of motifs and concepts that will return in the other films, even gnawing on an implement at the wrong end and being disgusted by shoe polish, something that we see in at least one other movie.
Holes in shoes and socks?
Everyone's got holes in shoes and socks. This is the Great Depression, after all. It's a worldwide phenomenon. Also, children getting hurt in accidents.
Well, children in general being the only reason people are living.
Right.
And accidents as a plot resolution device. He is really leaning on those hard in this silent era.
Yeah. You gotta wonder, and I don't know if the articles that you read mention anything about this, but feel a sort of King Vidor, the crowd vibe in a lot of these.
No one mentions Vidor, nope.
But I imagine Vidor would have been seen in Japan. We know that The Stranger's Return was Ozu's favorite American film.
Right.
The Crowd was certainly a much more famous movie, I'm sure. It got some screenings in Japan. I don't know if it influenced Naruse or not, but I did detect some genetic linkage there. So this is the story of a flunky, a not very successful insurance salesman who is not having a good time. His wife is not happy with their lot in life.
She's barely characterized. The movie is all him, basically, with a little bit of his son, and he is comedy dad, kind of a helpless, hapless figure.
He's just trying to find a way to bring in enough for everyone to stop complaining.
He's not a heavy, though. He's a man-child.
Yeah, definitely. The landlord comes. It's interesting because it's clear that she's been running the household and dealing with all of these problems, and she's sick of it, and it's driven her a little bit crazy, and she's acting quite badly in this movie, but you have to remember that he has kind of abdicated all responsibility, and we certainly see that when he's hiding from the landlord in the closet. She's basically said, I'm not doing it this time. I'm not telling him that we don't have the money, so you do it. She's been maybe a little bit past the breaking point, it seems. She's sweeping the floor in a kind of caricature of the woman's role around the house, to the point where he's not sure if she's gonna hit the baby with the broom, like, as she sweeps, because she just doesn't care anymore.
Well, she's also sweeping away their wedding portrait.
Oh yeah, well, she's sick of that. Seems really by design, but everything else, it just seems like she's on autopilot. She just can't be bothered to even look around anymore at what's happening.
Dave Kerr thinks that in this comic context, the wife comes off as cold-hearted by comparison to this man-child husband, but I think we understand the story, as you're saying. We understand the archetypes, and I don't think we're unsympathetic to her. It's just not important. She's the context, the background.
Yeah, well, you just have to be cognizant of the fact that we are introduced at a very dire stage in a marriage, and she's been through a lot, and I think the movie gives you enough to understand that. You don't have to take her at face value as if this is day one and she's acting like this.
And luckily, unlike in Dark at the Top of the Stairs, he's not pestering her for sex.
No, that seems like he's given up on that a long time ago. I guess the last time they had a baby, which is not that long ago, because there's a very young child that he's carrying around at times, but I don't think there's any more of that happening.
Nobody's having any sex in any of these movies. It almost kind of starts to maybe become a thing in Apart From You, but then, well, the parting happens.
True, but the family where they have five kids that everyone wants to sell insurance to, there's clearly sex going on there.
Well, I guess. There's also sex going on in the house in Apart From You, where the father is pimping out all of the girls.
That's right. That's a bad dad. But we'll get to that one later. A lot of the 29 minutes of runtime for Flunky Work Hard is devoted to a comedy set piece where our protagonist tries to sell insurance to this prosperous woman.
Kerr talks about this as being almost like a Hal Roach comedy, and it's true, but at the same time, you can feel the desperation of this guy to an extent that it's not funny.
It's the economic system making a clown of this man, which is not how a Hal Roach movie works.
Yeah, exactly. At the same time, you can feel, or I felt for, because who hasn't been harassed at some point by an insurance salesman, you can feel for this middle-class woman who just keeps getting pestered by these men who are desperate to make a living. And I'm sure even her middle-class home is being affected by the Depression.
Just get out of here. This is not a playground.
This is not a playground for you, she says to them as they start nearly getting into a fist fight.
Yeah, well, they have several start and stop confrontations.
Now, this one was written by Naruse. And I do think it's clever the way that it kind of perfectly imitates or uses these comic archetypes and archetypal situations and yet infuses them with this economic desperation.
The son is introduced you know, right at the beginning as kind of a problem. He is a bit of a liar. He's a bit antisocial. He's getting into fights.
He's a little delinquent.
Yeah, the other kids hit him, but clearly he hurt this other boy a lot more. And he seems to be fearlessly courting danger at all times and happy to dish out as much punishment as he can.
There's quite a set piece where he
takes on five kids.
He's being attacked by all of these other boys that he plays with, and he, yeah, takes them all on and keeps hiding on them and jumping out at them and really brutally thrashing them.
And he's angry because everyone else has toys and he doesn't, so he's going around breaking their toys and getting into fights.
Oh, we see that again in Every Night Dreams, where the child keeps asking for presents and money. That's a much more innocent child than this little jackass, but the idea is the same, right? That the children, their role in this economic system, they're expecting a certain standard of living just like the wife is.
Well, and especially if they're deprived of their parents, they're like, well, if you're gone, surely you brought a present back with you. Otherwise, where were you?
Well, everyone knows how this goes. I was just talking about this when we did Swiss Family Robinson and Dark at the Top of the Stairs, talking about my grandfather coming home from his conventions and always bringing me a present.
It's a natural expectation.
Well, I don't know. It's natural, but it was part of the middle class in the early 20th century that my grandfather still knew how to do this, right? I'm sure he did it for his own kids.
Well, because absence from the nuclear home is equated with economic productivity. So if you go away and you come home empty-handed, that's like a double whammy. Like, you're not justifying the time you spent away from the home.
It's even in the Beauty and the Beast story, the merchant who comes back with presents for his daughters, and that starts him down a very dark path.
Now, the father makes a terrible mistake at the end of all of these shenanigans when first he's sort of counseling his son that, well, if they started it, that's the time when you're allowed to fight back. But the problem is that he notices that one of the kids that has been beaten up is part of this family he's trying to sell insurance to, and then he just lashes out at his son. He's like, well, you've just torpedoed my last chance to make some money.
And he even comically beats his son a little bit. The son is refusing to apologize, and the interplay between these two, Isamu Yamaguchi is playing Okabe, the husband-father, and Salichi Kato is playing Susumu, his son. To me, it's just so perfect the way they interact, where on the one hand, the father's treatment of the son is concerning in this scene, but at the same time, you feel that he's still helpless. He still just has absolutely no control over this child.
No.
He can't make anything go the way he wants it to.
What ensues is certainly not what he wants, which is his son getting hurt and in a life-threatening situation. And we will see this again in some other movies.
But even before that, he goes back to the middle-class woman's home to apologize for this thrashing and finds out that a child was hit in a railway accident, hit by a train. That's a ghoulish opportunity to get her to insure her kids. So now he's finally got his sale. That's when he thinks back, well, now that he's fed, so to speak, he's in a better frame of mind. He thinks back to his last interaction with his son and he feels bad about it. And so he's like, oh, well, now I can finally get him the toy that's causing all of this trouble.
Turns out that it is his son that got hurt. And so the sale was made at the cost, possibly, of the life of his own child.
So it's really, as I say, it's really ghoulish that this whole story turns around life insurance.
Well, again, in the first scene, well, I guess toward the end of the first scene, when the mother comes with the other child who has been beaten up by Susumu, she's complaining about this beating, but also talking about, your husband does sell insurance, right? I guess I better get insurance for my boy if this beating keeps up. Very nicely integrated, all of that.
So let's not spoil the ending. We won't let you know if the child lives or dies, but now that we've talked about it, I really feel, you know, I think of the Jane Austen's Juvenilia is the best that I'm familiar with and comparable, because it's not that Naruse turned out to be a comic director, but that hers are comic. Now that we've discussed this, I really feel like this is a perfect work of Juvenilia, in that all of the director's auteur concerns are just so perfectly mapped onto this very slight slapstick structure.
One thing that we should say is that this wife, who has been acting very cold and standoffish throughout the early parts of the movie, does kind of come back into the fold as the family gathers around the bed.
Right. The two of them are both there, very upset.
Yeah, so she does care about people. We met her just on a bad day. And I think the movie makes that clear, that this is not the essence of what she is. This is something that she's been turning into because of these terrible circumstances, which have adversely affected both parents in different ways.
And the child, too.
Well, of course, the child. Yeah.
Child's a little psychopath.
All right. No blood relation.
This one is the one that's least concerned about economic struggles. Like, the primary struggle faced by the characters is not economic. However, it still does very much come into the drama.
Well, it certainly does. A lot of it does turn on the embarrassed financial situation of the family that has been raising this child. That becomes the main issue of the film. Who's going to gain custody of this child?
This one was written by Koko Noda, a frequent Ozu collaborator, based on a novel.
It has great roles for both of the lead actresses and for the child. This is probably
I loved this child actor.
Yeah, she's got the most agency of any child we've seen in a long time in a film. She drives a lot of the narrative. It's her own wishes that are paramount here. She's fighting back.
Well, we did see Old Yeller recently.
Well, that's true.
That's an older child, though. I just love this little actress so much. Her face is adorable, and yet she's not sentimentalized.
So it's got a very complicated build-up, this one. We start with some thieves working their pickpocketing grift on the streets.
These guys are the comic relief of the movie.
They're petty criminals. We meet them at the conclusion of a successful theft, and they wander back to the harbor where they mainly ply their trade, but they're very excited because the newspapers are full of the miraculous return of a woman who had gone to the United States, to Hollywood, to become a huge star. Turns out that she is the sister of one of the guys.
So this is Yoshiko Okada, stage and film actress who defected to the Soviet Union in the 1930s.
Amazing. Well, here she had defected to the United States, but she came back because she's made a huge amount of money and now has terrible regrets because she had abandoned her family, which included this wonderful daughter.
She did leave them for another man, her husband says, but yeah, obviously this had something to do with her film career.
Yeah, she ran off and did 6 years worth of movies, comes back to Japan, and a celebrity, and wants to atone for what she's done. Get to know her daughter. That's her plan. Her brother is gathering intelligence. They've discovered everything that she needs to know about the situation. The ex-husband has remarried, and we meet this group right after that. This is our other standout female role, source of the title. She's not the blood mother of Shigeko, but they've formed a very strong bond, and the father is some kind of entrepreneur, but things have not been going well, and they've been getting worse.
On the Wikipedia, very small Wikipedia page for this film, there's a little section recounting that Naruse's biographer, Catherine Russell,
she's at Concordia University,
she linked No Blood Relation to other Naruse films of the same era by using the popular but controversial figure of the moga, modern Japanese girl with Western values and Western fashion style, who contrasted with another woman or sister. So she's contrasting with this new wife and stepmother, but Tamea, I don't know how you'd pronounce her name, the actress, she behaves pretty terribly during this movie. But I don't think she's ever portrayed as a villain.
No, she's just really confused. Toward the end of the movie, it becomes clear why an actress would want this part, because she gets to do a lot of very complicated reassessing of her position in the whole drama.
And I don't know how often this was used as a trope. It kind of sounds like, if this was based on a novel, maybe it wasn't that typical. Like, maybe this novel was famous for tackling this issue, right? So this idea that blood relation doesn't make the mother, I would assume in 1932 this would still be a relatively controversial idea.
It's like the perfect opportunity, though, for her to come back into the life of her daughter, or so she thinks, because her ex-husband is in the newspapers himself for going bankrupt and defaulting on payments to his workers. She arranges for a meeting with him and says, you know, here, I'll give you the money you need, back your company, just give me custody of our child. He's like, no, you're a bad woman. I'm never going to forgive you for what you did. I'd rather go to jail than take your money. And go to jail he does. That's the upshot of all of that.
It never occurs to her that she might share custody.
It's a pretty acrimonious confrontation between them. I don't blame her for thinking it's all or nothing here. Because this guy clearly is not in the mood to forgive and forget.
Yeah, so she resorts to kidnapping.
And the reason that they're able to get away with all of that is because, so the patriarch is gone, he's in jail. The head of the household now is the patriarch's mother. She's another character like the wife in Flunky Work Hard, right? She is really presented as a person driven to very bad behavior by fear of poverty. In this case, she's never had to live in a small house without servants, etc., etc., and she is deeply embittered by it, to the point where as soon as she learns this, she throws the cat aside and starts acting like an absolute tyrant around the house. She is eager to make a deal with the blood mother so that she can be restored to the life that she was accustomed to.
Before this plot takes off, we do get an example of the bonding that has taken place between Shigeko and Masako.
Yeah, the extent of the devotion between them. It's essential to have a scene where there's an accident in the making.
Yet another accident. Two accidents in this one.
In this first accident, the child is not harmed, but only because of the heroic actions of the stepmother. Takes a car in the side for the team here. Bedridden. And it's a pretty amazing scene when, as she lies there recovering, her daughter comes in.
She says, "How can I sleep knowing that you..." I can't remember what she says exactly, but you're sick because you were protecting me.
Because you tried to save me.
Yeah.
Or because you did save me. Yeah, it's beautiful. Really well done.
And then the stepmother says, "That will make me well. Your words will make me well."
And it's true. She does get well. And, you know, not long after that, she has to get up because she sees that her husband is being dragged away by the cops and will never return until the end of the movie.
Now, the first time Shigeko is approached by her blood mother, she already has a very, very adverse reaction.
Well, she's been given all the lessons on stranger danger, which is great. Yeah, she just yells at her. Kidnapper?
Dummy?
Think I'm gonna fall for that? And she keeps turning around and yelling another insult at her as she heads back to the house. It's pretty great.
But that's what I mean. It's an anti-sentimental scene, obviously, and it really shows you from a child's perspective how psychotic this woman would appear. She literally says, "Want to get in the car with me? You can come and meet your real mother."
Yeah, it sounds very creepy. In this case, it happens to be true, but it's still creepy. And she goes right home and says, "A woman tried to kidnap me. She's over there in her car."
But then she has to go through the mother-in-law. Kidnapping looks all the creepier because there are these two petty criminals there acting as bodyguards slash uncles.
There's just no one to defend this diminished family.
There is someone. There's this friend of the family.
Yeah, I mean, he does his best, but he doesn't have authority, right? He can't even press charges, clearly, because I guess maybe the laws would be on the side of the original mother.
Well, I guess, I don't know, maybe because the father's in prison, then yes. At any rate, they don't have the money to fight a court case.
No, they don't have any money.
And yeah, trust me, parts of my family have been through custody cases and they are tedious and horrible and traumatic and take money.
So it really becomes about moral suasion. That's the only way Shigeko is going to come back, is going to be allowed to come back.
And she just refuses and refuses and refuses to respond to this woman and keeps begging for her mother. But it's insistent. Again, it's not played in a sentimental style.
No, and the child is full participant in the scenes. It's not like she is confused. I mean, she knows exactly what's going on. She knows this woman. She understands the concept of, "I'm your real mother." And she's like, "It doesn't matter. I don't care."
Keeps saying, "I want my other mother." No, she keeps calling the stepmother her real mother.
Yeah.
She understands that now she has two mothers, but she'd prefer to go back to the other one, the real one.
All of that, it works on the minds of everyone.
It's very slowly, though. This is a huge portion of the movie. This goes on for a very long time. Yeah, I like the way it is played realistically, the way maybe this really would work if this happened, because...
Well, they're trying to wear her down, but what happens in effect is that she wears them down.
Well, she just keeps, you know, they keep trying to play with her and what have you, and she just keeps walking over to her grandmother and saying, "Okay, time to go home now, Grandma."
Stockholm Syndrome in reverse. I guess maybe a little bit like Ruthless People, in a way. The prisoner winds up making everyone identify with her point of view. But it doesn't happen overnight, and other contingencies have to occur before the full effect can be realized. But the fact that Masako is a determined mother as well, and winds up showing up at this house, which is kind of dangerous for her because these guys are not being gentle. They're not killers, but they're definitely not averse to shoving people around and dragging them away.
Well, the little girl almost overpowers them when she sees her real mother. They have to pull both of them away from each other.
It is the grandmother that opens the door to Masako.
Eventually.
Yeah.
The second time.
That's right.
And what happens in between is that Shigeko, realizing no one's going to take her home, just runs away.
And gets hurt.
And gets in another accident, yes.
Yeah, gets hit by a bicycle.
Right, after the wacky uncles start running after her.
The inciting event that draws Masako to the window. She just wants to get in there, and if she can't get in there, she's at least going to watch over her daughter any way that she can. The grandmother feels a need to let her in. She confesses that she just never understood the depth of the bond between the two.
Well, that's after Shigeko says to her, "Grandma, why aren't you taking me home to my real mother? I'm starting to hate you too."
Yeah, that's right. It's pretty good.
And I mean, fair question.
Is it just because this actress has $600,000? That does not compute to a child. Once Tamei comes in and witnesses all of this as well, I mean, she's determined. You know, when she's a woman who has succeeded in so many things in her life, this is where really it becomes much more about her than about Masaki. I mean, we know the drama of Masaki and we've been with her for a lot of it and felt things along with her. But at this point, it really becomes Tamei's story as she struggles with herself, as she has to let go of this desire to reconnect with her daughter. She has to understand that the only thing she can do for her daughter at this point is let her go back to Masaki.
Is the mother-child bond so fragile, she says.
Yeah.
What we're more used to seeing, or what I'm more familiar with in melodramas of the 30s and 40s is, well, the plot where the blood mother has to give up her child because she's pregnant out of wedlock, then has to pretend that it's not her child, and then is tortured by wanting to win the child over later in life, and where we're operating from her perspective the entire time, and once the child, who's probably an adult by the time the plot resolves, finds out, oh, this is my mother, and you had to give me up, and I understand why now, it's all this very sentimental conclusion, and that can be nice, I like those melodramas, but this is quite unusual.
It is. Final resolution, after much torture, is that she really does take all the actions you've been kind of conditioned to hope she might, which is give her fortune, her entire fortune, to her daughter, and then head back to America to make more money, I guess. That's the life she's gonna lead. I mean, everyone's happy except for her. She is still pretty torn up on the boat. She bails her ex-husband out of jail, too. I guess she pays off all of the money he owed, and he is released. It's still a wrenching departure for her.
You can imagine a sequel, once Shigeko grows up, where she actually does have that sense of, oh, okay, I understand what that woman was doing now, and now I do feel sorry for her. You know?
Yeah.
In the meantime, she is passionately devoted to her real mother, and that's where she's going to stay.
And that's reasonable, too. It's all very authentic, the feelings that we see between those two, and maybe grandma's gonna be a little nicer now, too, after what they've all been through, and...
They've got money again, so she should be in a better mood.
She'll pet the cat again and brush the cat. Husband, hopefully, will be a little more careful in his business dealings from now on, too. When we first were introduced to the group, I wasn't sure if he was Masaki's husband or father, right? He's older than her, for sure. Mm. And we don't get a great sense of their romantic relationship.
But no, nobody. We don't get a great sense of anybody's romantic relationships, as I was saying, in any of these movies.
It's really interesting that Tamei's assistants, it's her brother, right? She doesn't have a paramour who is her co-conspirator or anything.
It is interesting because in his mature works, Naruse, they often are romantic stories, very...
Oh, yeah.
Very sad ones, usually. These movies are more interested in family than in romantic relationships.
And the friend of the family is a pretty interesting character, too, because it always seems like it could turn into a different kind of movie and he could get romantically involved somehow, but he doesn't. I mean, he has his own family.
Yeah.
But he has quite an active role, even though he doesn't actually achieve anything.
Nope.
Really.
Nope.
He tries to negotiate on behalf. Like, he's the go-between, but no, he doesn't succeed in doing anything. It's all negotiations between the women that achieve the results.
Well, who knows what's going on with all these satellite characters in the novel?
But I think it's kind of cool, and it has to be by design, that these men really don't figure substantially in the results. They just are taking actions constantly that wind up going nowhere, and it's the women that settle it.
Well, neither do they in Stella Dallas.
That's right.
These two women and their relationship with the child, that's what's important here.
That comes later, and it's not a property that Vidor introduced to the world, because there was a Stella Dallas from the 20s, but again, some Naruse-Vidor parallels, at least.
True.
Every Night Dreams.
This one came closest to feeling like almost maybe a masterpiece, like a really pretty great film.
Oh, it's so good.
And it's the grimmest. It's so grim. And it also feels like I'd have to go back and watch more of his sound films again. But it feels like a mission statement or a philosophical statement. It is based on a story by Naruse and has a screenplay by another Ozu collaborator. I mean, all of these people collaborated with Ozu because they're at his studio.
Right.
This is Tadeo Ikeda.
So this one starts out with a bang. We've got women getting off a boat, walking up the pier, and these two sailor guys are just dying to interact with her. It turns out they know her from the bar that she works at. She's really cool. She's got them kind of on the back foot. They're so dazzled by her, and she asks for a cigarette. They're stumbling over each other to get her a cigarette and get her a light. She's just so in control of this situation. A tremendous introduction to this actress, Sumiko Kurishima.
Yeah, but of course, then as soon as she gets home, we realize she's not in control of anything.
No.
And she's very exhausted.
In 5-10 minutes with this woman, we see so many different facets. We see the public face that she's able to project of strength and all the pressures working on her behind the walls of her house, where she is a boarder with some very nice people who are helping her to take care of her son.
Wikipedia says that this actress is often considered Japan's first female movie star.
Oh, I loved her. I thought she was so good. We're fairly familiar now with the golden age of Japanese cinema in the 50s and the performers that you meet there. But 1930s in Japan is pretty new to both of us.
Well, we saw a few otherwise unknown to us actors when we did the Setsuko Hara series. We've managed to find a few of her films from the 30s.
Yeah, but a lot of these people, I think, were pretty important stars, and we're seeing these people for the first time. Obviously, there's a lot going on in Japan in the 1930s as well, even though scholars tend to focus on the post-war years.
Well, you were saying we see this contrast between her public show of strength and how she really feels when she gets home. But that's going to be, like I was saying, the thesis or mission statement of this movie. The need to publicly project strength.
Yeah, otherwise you're going to get run over by these horrible men and women. The woman who runs the bar is awful.
But I mean, you're going to get run over by life.
Yeah.
You're going to get hit by the truck of life.
No doubt.
An apt metaphor for Naruse at this period.
She's not a geisha in this movie, but it's like a clip joint. It's like Betty Davis marked woman, right? That's what they're doing. They're there to encourage men to drink, and then whatever happens to them as a consequence of that, nobody cares.
Right. There is a particular man, the captain, who's interested in her. And the woman who owns the bar, or manages it, or whatever is happening there, she wants to encourage him to keep coming. I mean, we've seen this in lots of Hollywood movies from the 30s and 40s, where the employee is just supposed to keep the man sweet.
Yeah, but she admits that Omitsu is like the main attraction at her bar. She's like, I can never tell her that. And the unspoken statement there is that if I did, I'd have to pay her more money, because she's obviously lowballing her.
Yes, but this captain wants a physical relationship. He wants an affair.
The boss doesn't really care. Right?
Yeah, if anything, she would like it to happen.
Sure. She's not going to step in to stop it, that's for sure.
I was thinking of that weird Lucille Ball movie, the weird sort of noir mystery movie where she is briefly working at a club, where we see a scene showing that she is encouraged to go off with any man who asks her to. That's more of a high class joint than this one, but I was thinking it was a similar vibe.
Yeah, the Cirque movie. So when she returns, she's told that a man has been around asking questions about her. And that's left ambiguous. I wasn't sure what was going to happen there. Was there some kind of detective after her? Or was it an abusive former lover? What was it all about? And that does sort of linger in the background for a while until he returns and we actually meet this guy. He is the father of her son, a sad sack who has abandoned them 3 years ago.
But do we ever find out why?
It sounds like he's just shiftless, right? I mean, he's certainly not abusive or angry. He freely admits that he acted badly and he's been useless to her, and he just wants one look at his son. He wants a chance to be a father to his son, even for a minute. He's immediately sympathetic, even though, you know, you're so fully involved in her worldview that you're certainly looking at him askance.
Well, he is immediately sympathetic. He's sympathetic throughout the whole thing. He's never portrayed as a villain, and he's not portrayed as extravagantly useless. We do see him trying to find work. It does seem like
he has a heart condition. He can't do heavy labor.
Although he eventually applies for it. So I don't know how much he is actually a sad sack.
Well, he's a sad sack in the way that he presents himself to her, because he is repentant. And she's really trying to order him out, but you could see that she's fighting other instincts. She clearly still has feelings for this man that she doesn't want to deal with, and eventually she kind of allows those to sway her.
But again, they're in such a horrible position. Like, they don't have a lot of money, he can't find work, neither of them likes the kind of work that she's doing, that whatever romantic feelings may exist between them, it's just certainly not what the movie's about, and it's certainly not giving them any solace.
No. The child in this movie, Fumio, is great as well. Another pretty lovable child.
Yeah, not as good as No Blood Relation.
No, but he's an interesting little character, and he does, you know, have an important part to play even before he gets hurt.
His mother is like pulling him aside while he's trying to play with his toys and being like, just make something of yourself when you grow up. Make something of yourself. Terrifying.
Well, yeah, she's pretty depressed about the state her life has fallen into. She despises her job, but this is the way that she can make money. It's not so different from Flunky Work Hard in that sense, right? I mean, it's someone pushed into a demeaning job by economic necessity. It's gendered in characteristic ways of the time. A man has to go out and try to sell insurance, and a woman has to hang out in a bar and convince men to drink.
We get to the point where her husband is desperate. He's not only desperate to become the breadwinner again, but for the first time,
yeah,
but also just to get her out of this work that they both find degrading for her, and that he does particularly find degrading for her. Like, I was thinking, of course, it's not prostitution, but I was thinking of Hen in the Wind and how this guy has a reaction that's equally determined by patriarchy, but opposite, right? That he just feels this immense shame that she has to do this kind of work, right? Rather than feeling jealous rage.
Yeah, you know, he's certainly not, and it's legitimate in a sense, right? The fear that he has is that one of these guys is going to sexually assault her, which is an ever-present possibility. I mean, we see it at the bar.
He actually interferes with her work by coming there once when that's happening.
Yeah, the captain is getting really out of hand. The bar patrons are presented in a fairly complex way. You know, most of them actually do seem to be fairly respectful of her. I mean, we see the two guys from the pier who are contemplating jumping in to help her, but they don't really do it. I guess we don't know what they would have done if the husband hadn't come along. So it's certainly not like everyone thinks that it's okay to behave like this toward her and toward the women that work there. But all it takes is one, really, for your whole life to be ruined, because the authorities are not doing anything about this stuff, clearly, and the business owner is not. We do see some interesting moments with the father and son. You know, the son is actually delighted to have two parents, finds it an interesting novelty. There's the scene, which is an echo of Flunky Work Hard, where there's a hole in the shoe and the son tries to fix it while the dad is up at bat while they're playing baseball. They bond over that. Pretty nice use of these little understated props filled with holes to show us, you know, some of the lived detail of life on the ragged edge like this.
Your socks always have holes, even though you could definitely afford socks without holes.
It's true, but there were many times in my life when I couldn't, and I just got used to wearing socks with holes.
Oh my god, that's a really sad sack story, Dave.
Yep. You don't throw away a sock if it's got a hole in it, just a little one. You keep wearing it because you don't know if you're going to be able to buy another pair.
Oh, wow.
We come to another crisis point in this movie where Fumio gets hit by a car or a truck and is badly injured. Doesn't seem like he's going to die, but if he's going to heal properly, he has to go to the hospital, which takes a lot of money. Obviously, there is no socialized medicine at this time pretty much anywhere, and they don't have the funds that are required. And when the doctor reveals this information, it's like, thanks for telling us. Doesn't help us at all. What are we going
to
do?
Well, she is decided she's going to go back to work because she has agreed to stop working there while he looks for a job, but...
But she's got to go back. Someone's got to bring in big money. The captain, of course, is the one offering the biggest amount of money, but there are strings attached to this offer. He is no good Samaritan.
Right, and so she is obviously prepared to do that, and the husband is prepared to do whatever it takes for that not to happen.
One of those insoluble dramas. I mean, you can see everyone's point of view, right? And he stalls her off and says, I've got some friends I can ask for the money. So she's like, all right, I'll give you a little time on that. But if not, I've got to go get this money, whatever it takes.
So his only plan here is to steal this money. This is the last act that he can commit to feel like a man, to feel like a decent husband and father, is to steal this money and then kill himself from the shame and the fact that of his ongoing uselessness. And she doesn't treat him very nicely when she finds out what he's done. She's just, oh my god, you've made things worse. What are you doing?
You can certainly understand why she would say that.
Of course, but at the same time, I think we're pretty far inside his point of view, right?
You just feel terrible for everyone.
Even Frieda Freiberg is a little bit dismissive of this movie. She does say that Every Night Dreams and Apart From You are strong melodramas, which impress the Japanese film critics. They rated highly in the annual Best 10 list of Japanese films, and introduced the two themes that would persist throughout Naruse's oeuvre. Single women battling to support their ungrateful families, well, not ungrateful in Every Night Dreams, but anyway, and retain their self-esteem, and unhappy couples who cannot live apart or together. Maybe? But anyway, she also says the melodramatic events of Every Night Dreams, abandoned wife faces prospect of prostitution, son has serious accident, husband returns but commits crime and then suicides, would be much less in evidence in the later works, but the social realist setting and the focus on losers and battlers remain. That seems a little, like when you summarize it like that, it makes it sound like a crazy, silly melodrama, but that's not how the events feel as they unfold in this film.
No, I think these movies feel very grounded.
And just terrible. You're just like trapped in a nightmare.
Every night, nightmares.
Then the resolution is just this woman reacting to her husband's suicide by declaring that he's a weakling and that you must be strong to not run away from life. And I do feel like this, I mean, obviously this is partly her grief.
Yeah, of course.
And the way the actress performs the scene, you can see that. She's not just being cruel or Nietzschean about it.
No, she loves this guy.
Yeah, but at the same time, I do feel like this is a mission statement on the director's part, that you cannot run away from life. It is awful, and you do have to face it, but it does leave me asking why. I mean, in these films, the answer is children. Although we'll get some question, an interesting questioning of that, and Apart From You, which could be a sequel to Every Night Dreams, right? But if you don't have a child to live for and hope that their life is better than yours, why would you keep, what is even the point of trying and trying and battling in this way? You don't see a lot of the pleasures in life that might make it worth living other than the hope for their children.
No, but you do see some relationships that are very warm and mutually supportive. Her relationship with the husband and wife that she boards with.
True.
I find that indicative of the kinds of human relationships that
could form under better social conditions.
That could just encourage you to cling to life while other things are going horribly. I do think that he manages to get relationships like that into every movie that we've seen, one way or the other. So it's not saying, you know, all humans are horrible and there's nothing to cling on to.
Yeah, it's not Bresson.
No, not at all. It's just that everything's stacked against you, and sometimes it might not be enough to have these great friends who are trying everything they can think of to help out. The man that she rents from has a job as a medical salesman, and he's the one that tries to get a job for her husband, but he fails. He's not powerful enough to do it. And when asked about it later, he's like, well, I kept trying until they said if I ask again, they're gonna fire me.
So I guess the wife's answer in this movie would be, you know, if I have to be a prostitute, I have to be a prostitute, and
right.
You shouldn't have let these patriarchal standards destroy you. Because this was just the thing that we needed to face, I guess.
Well, I think so, right? That's the pragmatic response to all of this. And it hasn't destroyed her to do this job. It just has not delighted her, that's for sure. It has impacted her self-esteem and impacted her sense of what the good life is, but not to such an extent that she's unable to continue. And that's a, you know, a resilient heroine, which we will get over and over and over again in Naruse. Speaking of which, apart from you, so this too has two great roles for women.
The mother in this film is Mitsuko Yoshikawa.
And she is a geisha who has been plying the trade for a considerable length of time, according to the film. Now, again, I think it's a business that you get old in very quickly, unfortunately.
This actress is only 32, so they've given her the ugly makeup treatment like Dorothy McGuire in Enchanted Cottage.
Yeah, she's supposed to look a little bit older and more worn out than that.
Which basically just means don't put any makeup on her and give her a couple of spots in her face.
And some gray hairs coming in, which she regards with horror in the mirror.
Well, we don't even actually see those.
Well, we see them when they've been plucked out.
So she is close friends with a young geisha. This is the other role that you're talking about.
Terugiku is the name of the character.
She's a lovely young actress.
Sumiko Mizukubo. Again, someone I don't think we've seen in any other movies. So many of these stars of the early 30s, just brand new to me.
This actress is only 16.
Really?
Good lord. She seems more mature than that.
Yeah, she really does. So yeah, they have formed a very close bond. They can talk over problems. And Terugiku has developed a strong affection and turns out to be something more like romantic love than we might at first suspect for Yoshio, the son of Kikue, who is a guy in his late teens as well, who is supposedly nearing the end of his studies and maybe going off to pursue some higher education. That's the dream that his mother has for him, and that's why she's doing the job that she does, which she hates.
But he's turning into a delinquent, and he has, you know, he's at the adolescent stage of self-embarrassment, where he's not very pleased with his mother's profession.
No, he has really started to shut her out of his life, and we're told that, you know, they were very close in the past. He was a wonderful son, and Terugiku talks about how much she loves the man that he used to be, or the boy that he used to be, and why can't he go back to being that way?
He's all that she has, obviously. So again, like I said, this could be, although Apart From You is actually the slightly earlier film in its release, it could be a sequel to Every Night Dreams. We have a woman who has been doing a form of sex work for many years just in order to give a better life to her child, and then he grows up to be ungrateful for it. And because of that, maybe not even going to turn out the way that she hoped.
No, he's ungrateful to the point of self-hatred, and he has gotten involved with gangs. This is a tough crowd. Any night, he could wind up getting stabbed in an alley. That seems to be the way he's going.
This was another one, like Flunky, Work Hard, the writing is just described to Naruse. And this also reminded me of Hen in the Wind, so maybe these sorts of themes were common enough in Japanese film and literature at the time. I don't know. But yeah, just the working through of the son's shame over his mother's work is what reminded me of Hen in the Wind. The style of Naruse is not to be, is anti-transcendence, is another thing that Senses of Cinema article was talking about. In contrast to the Japanese directors who found favor earlier in the West or in America, Naruse is never dealing with overt themes of transcendence. So like Hen in the Wind is an uncharacteristic Ozu film in that it's quite hysterical, and that its transcendence is more overt for that reason, but his cinema of transcendence has been talked about in relation to his more famous later films as well.
This communication breakdown between the mother and son has reached a point of complete impasse. The only thing that Kikue can think of to do is ask her friend, her young friend, to try to reach Yoshio, her son, and find out what's going on with them.
That's the thing that reminded me the most of Hen in the Wind, this whole journey she takes him on, where she brings him to her house to show him the reasons why she is living this lifestyle, much like the husband is taken. Well, he's not taken anywhere. The husband, Hen in the Wind, goes to this
brothel.
Yes, not even a geisha organization, it's just a brothel, to find out who these women were that his wife became. Right?
Like what sex work really is.
Yeah. And he finds himself sympathetic to the young woman that he meets there, and he understands why she did it, and he understands why his wife did it, but the irrationality of his feelings about it overtake him nonetheless. Now, this actually has a happier outcome in A Part From You, maybe because jealousy isn't any part of the son's problems with what his mother is doing.
Right, it's all about self-respect and his inability to respect himself because he can't respect his mother's line of work. And when he starts to get a better sense of how it all came about and what the social forces are that are shaping the life decisions that women had to make during this period, he gains a lot of insight. That visit to the seaside with Terugiku's family is just incredible. I mean, what a fascinating detour in the movie that becomes so essential. This woman, she's the eldest daughter, and she's clearly sending a lot of her money home. And now the next challenge is, well, there's another daughter who's just about the right age to be sent off to be a geisha as well, and she's going to do anything she can think of to prevent this from happening.
She stands up to her
drunken father.
Jackass drunken father.
Who is certainly spending a lot of the money that she sends back on sake, and the mother is ineffectual.
And she just keeps having babies by this guy. Well, what else is she going to do, I guess?
Yeah. She's not villainous, but she's not a help either. She's just there, and she's been beaten down clearly by life. And
yeah, the resources to leave him are probably not. He doesn't have them.
And we have a nice little humorous detour within the detour where Yoshio goes upstairs to wait while Terugiku has it out with her parents. One of the young children, a little boy, notices that he's got a hole in his sock, and they together decide to paint his toe black so that it won't show. So again, more dire straits, more poverty, and more little home remedies for these issues as a form of bonding. It's great. But he does come down in time to hear the end of this confrontation. I mean, they're yelling, and there's father wants to get up and attack her. I mean, he's a little too drunk to sustain his efforts, thankfully. But then they go out to the seashore, and she's like, you know, I'm sorry you had to see that, but actually, I wanted you to see that, which is just a wonderful two-part revelation.
Yeah. There's also the B plot, which is that Kakua's patron at the geisha house, her long-standing patron, wants a younger woman now.
He considers her a crone.
But he's too passive-aggressive to just dump her, because he doesn't want... Well, and we find out why, because once she finally gets the hang of it and gets drunk enough, and also because she thinks...
Well, her son is lost to her.
And... Yeah, exactly, that she did all this for her son, and now she's... It was all for nothing. So she turns out to not be the resilient heroine, because she is ready to kill herself there and then.
Yeah, it's a really interesting moment, too, where Terugiku is stuck with this guy, this dirty old man, as she calls him, and he's making no bones about it. He's ready to get rid of...
Well, knowing the actress is 16, we can tell what his idea of a crone is.
Yeah, I mean, he's
30.
He's a real creep, and she feels just terrible being in this position. I mean, she knows this guy is gross, but on the other hand, he's a main source of income for her best friend. She's worried her friend's gonna come in and resent her. You know, that could have been one way the movie goes, but that's not how it goes, thankfully. The women understand each other.
You know, there are jerk women in Naruse's movies, but that wouldn't usually be the way one of his movies would go, I don't think.
No, so Kikyo sees this and she's like, you know, don't worry, I'm not upset at you. But she is upset, clearly, because she starts drinking a lot and then tries to kill herself, as you say. It's not just about this. It's not that she loved this guy or anything, but she was depending on this meal ticket, and she's worried about whether she could ever get anyone else interested in her anymore, given the context, right? It's a reasonable worry.
Now, she does say she's only continuing as a geisha to finish putting her son through school, so I don't know if that means that she has enough money saved to have some kind of modest living afterwards.
Maybe. Another thing that we find out very early in the movie, which we sort of alluded to before, but I don't think we stated directly, he's not going to school at all. He's just hanging out with the gang.
Yeah.
It just all seems like it's crumbling.
Anyway, it all comes to a head with another violent accident, this time not involving any vehicles.
Yoshio
tries to get out of his gang.
He's convinced by what he's seen and what he's heard, and he understands a lot more about what's going on with his mother, and therefore he understands a lot more about what he's been doing incorrectly, and he wants to set matters straight, but it's not so easy. These guys are not going to just let him out of the gang, and all of this happens the night of his mother's attempted suicide, so she is now, she's been prevented from killing herself with this blade and dragged home. She's in bed, and he and Terugiku are at the bedside, but these guys come knocking and want to talk to him. It takes a little too long, and the mother's getting worried. Oh my god, he's just gonna go back to it again. And Terugiku is like, I'll go see. I'll go make sure he stays on this path, this corrected path. He's almost extricated himself from the situation. They all beat him up, but they're not gonna kill him.
But then he reverts back to patriarchal form and creates the movie's crisis, disaster, when one of them taunts his mother. So he's corrected insofar as he now likes his mother and wants to defend her, but he still obviously has internalized the shame of her work.
I think it's more than that, right? Because he's about to get out of it. They're like, you're not worth it anyway. Get out of here, you fool. Terugiku shows up and they notice her and they're like, oh, geisha. And it just opens up all these other opportunities for insults. And they throw that at him. Like, what do you expect from the son of a geisha slut? What he's doing there, he pulls out the knife and is furious with them because he's furious at himself for feeling that way about his own mother.
Oh, that's what you think?
Yeah, I don't think.
Maybe.
I don't think he's just overreacting and being a hothead. It's all just hitting him how he's been behaving. This is how I've sounded. And it just infuriates him and makes him want to lash out. Yeah, I think that
regardless, he still does completely the wrong thing, as the movie confirms by having
Terugiku get stabbed in the melee. I mean, yeah, attacking five guys when you're one person is not a good idea.
Attacking anybody with a knife is not a good idea.
No, of course not. So she gets stabbed, and we spend some time with her in the hospital, and it's like, oh my god, is she gonna die?
Well, she says she almost would rather, because her other option is, apparently she needs to go off somewhere far away where she can make more money from sex work, because only, and then send it back home to her family, because that's the only way her dad will agree to spare her sister.
So she's trapped, but she's so happy with that moment with Yoshio and the new understanding they've reached with each other. That certainly has the aspects of transcendence to it.
True.
This movie does have that, I think.
In Naruse's own way.
Yeah. She does recover, and then we have this heartfelt goodbye forever, it seems. And it does wind up being much more about this couple, this young couple, than about, because we see that he's reconciled to his mother, but the movie doesn't end with him and his mother. It's about him being separated from Terugiku.
Although he does indicate that
he will be taking care of his mother.
Yeah, so now he's going to have to take care of his mother.
Because he says, otherwise I'd go with you.
There's no real reason they couldn't go, although I guess his school is there.
Yeah.
But, I mean, obviously the idea that he could have a relationship to her while she's actively having to work as a geisha, like, it wouldn't work.
It would cause a lot of problems, undoubtedly, and maybe diminish her value on the market to have a boyfriend. So, yeah, it's a rough ending.
And hopefully he will make something so great of himself that he'll make a ton of money and be able to marry her in the end.
And buy off her dad and rescue the younger daughter and everyone.
All of the girl children will have to come and live with him. They'll have to just kill the father, I think.
Yeah, he deserves it. Not much redeeming about him. The movie takes no pains to render him anything less than a cardboard evil patriarch, drunken patriarch.
I don't know if these were the right movies to use for Criterion to use to introduce Naruse on DVD to Americans, but they're pretty damn great.
Yeah, I'm glad glad we watched them.
And they do need to all be seen together. I think they are much richer when you watch them all together and then think about, come at them from this angle of thinking about the material conditions of the characters and how they're affected.
Quite agree. All right, Elise, Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto. We went to our first non-repertory cinema screening since 2019, and we made this decision because of the overwhelming phenomenon that is Barbie by Greta Gerwig.
I wasn't aware that it was quite the juggernaut that it is when I went to see it. Obviously, I knew it had been a big hit already. Or when I decided to see it, I knew it had been a big hit. In this household, I hadn't been planning to see it, and nothing on earth could have moved us to see Oppenheimer, since you really hate Christopher Nolan, and I'm completely indifferent to him.
I'm very anti-Nolan. I don't think that's going to change.
But then my best friend since high school told me that she was going to go see Barbie, and I was like, well, I guess I'd like to be able to discuss this with people. I didn't have a problem with going to see a clever Barbie movie, which ever since Greta Gerwig's name was attached to it, everyone was saying it would have to be. I just hadn't particularly liked Greta Gerwig's two prior films.
Little Women was, in fact, the last movie we saw at the AMC Cineplex.
For that reason, I hadn't wanted to get my hopes up for it.
Maybe tell us a bit about your background with Barbie.
I was a great Barbie lover. I think I've actually had occasion to tell a Barbie anecdote or two on the pod in the long time that we've been doing it. But yeah, there were, from about the age, about 6 to 11, I played with Barbies, and Barbie in a book. Those were my two main desires for every birthday and every Christmas. When I started reading about, this is another thing that got me to go and see the movie. When I started reading about the movie, and by the way, if you've been thinking about, well, probably everyone who's been thinking about seeing the movie has already seen it by the time we're going to release this episode, but if you've been thinking about not seeing the movie, I am going to tell you, you should see it, because it's good, but don't read about it, and don't listen to what we have to say on this podcast, because the articles on it and the reviews spoil so many of the good moments that like half the film was spoiled for me, and I knew the jokes before I saw them. But I was encouraged to go see it because, now here come our spoilers, the articles all talked about the reverse hierarchy, where the Kens are second-class citizens in Barbie land. And I thought that was really, really a good insight into the way Barbie worked in the imagination of, I'm going to go out on a limb here and say most little girls. Well, obviously it's the case, because even as part of the marketing, Kens are second-class citizens, according to Mattel, right? And that's one of the jokes in the movie, too.
Nobody thinks about Ken.
Yeah, Ken is not a concern for us ever, Will Ferrell says. Because when I was doing my Proustian reflecting on childhood, it even gets into that memoir I wrote, that was one of the main things I reflected about in my Barbie playing, the oddity of how little Ken was valued. For example, in my middle-class household, the gifts were all of your gifts, all of your toys, all of your games, all of your books, all of that. That was only on Christmas and birthdays. I wasn't getting any of that stuff in between times.
Well, no, of course not.
Accordingly, I never ever wanted to waste a birthday or Christmas on a Ken. Ken was necessary because you needed the gender differentiation in order to have, you know, give your Barbies a realistic social life. So you had to have a Ken, but you didn't want to waste a Barbie gift on a Ken. He was so much less. So I had a Ken that my mom had given me that had belonged to her, but obviously it was not an 80s Ken, and it was basically an Alan. It was so pathetic, with its skinny little body and its crew cut. And so then I also got an 80s Ken. So I had the bad Ken and the good Ken. And then I felt like maybe I should have one more Ken, because I probably had like 8 Barbies or something. And then they came out with this Todd doll. And the Todd innovation, now this should have been put in the movie, but along with all of the other failed marketing Barbies.
Who was Alan? Alan was Ken's friend.
Yeah. we saw him at the end with all of the other bizarre Barbie concepts.
Right, right.
That yeah. didn't work. Ken's clothes fit him, right?
So right.
So you don't have to buy separate Alan clothes or anything. Anyway, so Todd, who had golden brownish hair, kind of the same color as his tan, as I recall, he bent. So he had an elastic inside of him that allowed him to bend. And this was a total innovation at the time.
So what is the purpose of that? He's agile?
He's agile. Yeah, he can move. Barbies were completely stiff at the time. They started to get into, you could bend Barbie's arms, but that was about it. Everything else was completely stiff and straight, and you couldn't pose them. Now they have poseable Barbies, but they freak me out because you can see the hinges, so they look like puppets. So I asked for a Todd doll, and then I played too hard with Todd. And when I was stretching him, I snapped his elastic band.
Well, that's inevitable, isn't it?
So then there was a Todd with a torso and a head, and then a Todd with flesh-colored underwear and legs.
Sort of like the broken C-3PO from the Star Wars movies.
A two-piece Todd, but the thing is, this is how much lesser Kens were. I was like, this is perfect. Now I can use them as two Kens. I can pretend that each one is a Ken and just imagine the rest of their body. And I never have to waste another Barbie gift on a Ken, because now I've got a total of four Kens. I gained a Ken instead of breaking a Ken. I did also have a weird Barbie, and I actually remember because it was so traumatic. I remember the occasion when she was created because I was playing with my stepsister. And when two girls get together with Barbies, the Barbies are in for a hard time. So we got together and we were playing with the Barbies. And, you know, I think what happened was that I was trying to fob off my uglier Barbies on my stepsister and keep the good ones for myself. So we were trying to decide which was the least attractive Barbie. And once we decided that, she became the scapegoat. Jen cut her hair. And I was just absolutely shocked. Shocked at this act of desecration. We had talked about it. I'd like goaded her into it. But I couldn't believe she actually did it. Because the problem with giving your Barbie a haircut is that it won't grow back. So
no.
You've permanently mutilated the Barbie. And then we both agreed that she was now destroyed. And so then Jen scribbled all over her. I just felt so bad for what we'd done to this Barbie. Because, you know, when you're a kid, you're animistic. And you attribute souls to all of your humanoid toys and stuffed animals. So I just had a lot of guilt forever about this Barbie. But I could not deny that not only was she originally the ugliest Barbie, but now what we had done to her, like, she just couldn't be played with anymore. So she just sat there as a lump of plastic guilt, right? In my collection. What else does this movie get right and wrong? It may be true that you had to be a Barbie girl or a baby doll girl, because I was not a baby doll girl. My mom gave me one of her own baby dolls and kind of guilted me into taking care of it by what she'd told me about it. The animistic thing again. I had been told that this looked like a real baby. It was a very special baby doll because it looked like a real baby. That is ugly. Therefore, I had to take really special care of it like it was a real baby. So again, I was just saddled with this big plastic lump of guilt that I didn't actually want to play with. Why did I want Barbies? What was Barbie all about? Barbie was beautiful. Just that in itself was why you wanted Barbie, because she looked beautiful. Little girls are allowed to appreciate beauty. And then the other reason is that her clothes were beautiful. Like, a Barbie with no clothes on was a useless hunk of plastic. And so, of course, the fashion, that was all about self-expression and identity exploration. You know, same thing, girls go through that in their teen years, and this was just prepping you for that. Well, same thing that drew me to... These are both the same things that drew me as a teenager to classical Hollywood cinema, the star system, the glamour of the actresses, and pop stars as
sure.
a teenager, too. So it's all ways of working out your own identity.
But when you were collecting Barbies, these were not being presented as lawyer Barbie, doctor Barbie.
Okay, so yeah, so I was saying the baby doll thing, that makes sense to me, that
President Barbie.
That Barbies were giving you different opportunities than just being socialized into motherhood. But no, I didn't care at all about Barbies having professions. I wanted Barbie to have cool clothes. That's what I cared about.
And is that something that clearly did at some point happen, that they started to diversify and emphasize the professions of these Barbies?
Well, I think pressure groups...
In the 90s, maybe.
Pressure groups caused them to, Mattel, to come out with Barbies that were more, you know, black Barbies and racially ambiguous Barbies and brunette Barbies. I could couldn't even find a brunette Barbie.
They were all stereotypical Barbie.
Yeah, I had to buy a really expensive special edition Italian Barbie to get a brunette Barbie. Because you wanted a Barbie to look like you, right? Just so you already identified with Barbie. It wasn't like Barbie was alienating you because she was blonde and perfect. Already you were identifying aspirationally with Barbie, right? But it would make it even better if you could pretend that she was a fantasy version of exactly you.
I certainly have spoken with women who, despite loving their Barbies, did take a message of blonde is more beautiful than anything else from that experience.
How would you know that? How would you consciously, like, I'm sure I did too, but...
Well, I've been told that. That's all I'm saying.
But I don't know how you would know that as a child. That would you look at your doll and be like, I guess all the Barbies are blonde because that's better? I don't know. I wasn't that analytical as a child. Maybe that's enough about me and Barbie.
So the execution of the film, how did you feel? I mean, it clearly had a strong emotional pull for you.
Oh, I started crying from the minute it started. Movies that are inspirational in any way, it really doesn't matter if they're good or bad. They just have... It's like a... TV commercial, sentimental TV commercial. It'll just do it to me. I'll just start crying. And I cried the whole time. Good thing I had some really good waterproof mascara on. Cried the whole time out of just one eye. I have no idea why that eye likes to cry.
So just seeing the Barbie houses dramatized before anything emotional happens, you were crying.
Well, no, there was like the music and the 2001 parody, obviously, and the destruction of the baby dolls and the giant monolith Barbie.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, obviously, Barbie does speak to me now as she did when I was a child as a concept. Oh, yeah, that's what I was going to say about blonde is better. On the contrary, I mean, maybe it worked that way for some girls, but on the contrary, I was desperate to find Barbies of any other color at the time, because by the time I was like 10 or 11, my two favorite celebrities were Tina Turner and Bette Midler. And I wanted Barbies that looked like Tina Turner and Bette Midler, and I did my damnedest to find them. I managed to find a curly redheaded Barbie. It was a rocker Barbie. There was a line of like rock star Barbies. And then a tan Barbie with a gold lamé outfit. So that was Tina Turner.
Boy.
So on the contrary, I really wanted them to stop being blonde, so they could look like the cooler celebrities that I was into. But should we talk about the movie as a movie? Those are some of the things that I felt it got right about the Barbie experience. Now, what a Barbie movie could have been if it hadn't been made by Margot Robbie and Greta Gerwig. And Margot Robbie, she has a production company, and she pitched these ideas to Mattel from the outset. So this Mattel did not come up with these ideas. This was out of Margot Robbie's brain. A Barbie movie could have been just a movie about a woman named Barbie who lived in...
Barbie Land.
Who just lived in Barbie Land, or who just lived in some version of reality that was like a Barbie Land and had her adventures, you know. This movie is a meta movie about the concept of Barbie. But more than that, it is a meta movie about the concept of Ken. So Gerwig has talked in her... I'm going to let you speak in a minute there, Dave. Gerwig has talked about Paradise Lost in relation to the movie's story arc for Barbie and for Ken, right? Adam and Eve and their fortunate fall. But she hasn't mentioned Satan, Milton Satan, in relation to the movie, but I think that that is actually the archetype of the Ken story arc. He is Milton Satan, and that is what makes him the most interesting character from a writer's perspective. And that is how he ends up stealing the movie.
Better to reign in Kendom. Yeah.
Yeah. So she is God, and he relates to her as though she is God. Her gaze is the only thing that reifies his existence, and he ultimately ends up rebelling against this, except it's a comic version of the satanic rebellion, and it is put down gently through topical pop culture jokes.
That was the thing I liked the least about the movie.
You were laughing, though.
I was laughing, but some of it just felt too much like a tweet, like some of the dialogue.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think that's just gonna be a pitfall of popular culture from now on for a while anyway. I liked the structure of the movie. I enjoyed the performances. Some of the dialogue I felt was very funny. Other parts of it I just felt like, no, this is just a hashtag thing. That I found a little bit obnoxious at times, but, you know, I guess it's not any more obnoxious than the way Joss Whedon writes, and we both enjoyed Buffy the Vampire Slayer. You know, getting across a kind of pop culture argument in one line of dialogue is risky.
This is a high concept movie, but it's also a very light and silly comedy, so I wasn't kind of breaking my head open over that sort of stuff. I thoroughly enjoyed it. I laughed throughout. Some of the more high concept stuff was the stuff that bothered me more because it was just very undigested Matrix style concepts.
Yeah.
Right? That I felt like if the movie had just digested that a bit more so that they weren't all there in the dialogue and they were more implied than stated, it would have been a lot better. So that bugged me. The pop culture references didn't bug me. I found myself asking, because I wanted to give it 5 stars, and I found myself asking afterwards, is this a timeless movie? Is this a movie for the ages? Will anyone understand these jokes 10 years from now, 20 years from now? I don't give a fuck. I enjoyed it, and the timeless aspects of it as a comedy were in Gerwig's direction of the actors and her sense of comic timing.
Yeah.
And Ryan Gosling's performance.
He was great. Well, so was Margot Robbie. I mean, they were both great.
They were both great, but they were great in different ways. And Ryan Gosling was giving a screwball movie star performance. The way that in the 1930s, actors who were not primarily known as comedians could just show up in a screwball comedy, give a masterpiece of a comic performance with the right director, right? And that's what's happened. And I was stunned because Gerwig's other two movies weren't comedies. So I didn't even know she could direct comedy this well. I was not expecting it.
My favorite line in the whole movie is one that, for me anyway, came out of nowhere, doesn't feel like a hashtag tweet. It was when Ken says that he lost all interest in patriarchy when he found out it wasn't about horses.
The delivery of that line,
it was so good.
The direction and the acting in the delivery of that line, it is the line of the movie.
Yeah,
for sure. What Margot Robbie did for the part, her part, was something, again, totally unexpected to me. I don't know anything other than the fact that she's really taken control of her career, made interesting choices, sometimes failed, like sometimes made very bad movies like Birds of Prey from all accounts.
You know, appearing as Harley Quinn, obviously most DC movies fail and are stupid, but it seemed to be pretty iconic for her anyway.
Yeah, so I'm going to be Barbie is her idea, because that's who I am as a movie star archetype, but I'm going to make this crazy meta Barbie movie that's all about the good, the bad, and the ugly of Barbie, right? But yeah, so I hadn't even seen her in anything other than kind of trying to watch the Harley Quinn movies and failing because they're so bad. Anything since Wolf of Wall Street.
That's a long time ago.
It's a long time ago now. So I was surprised by what she brought to this role for me that absolutely sold her and Gerwig's concept of Barbie, like stereotypical Barbie as a character. She was lovable.
Yeah.
Just completely lovable. And if she did not have that quality, this character was not going to work.
Yeah, I agree. You immediately care deeply about this character, this toy that has entered the real world and is shocked to discover that she hadn't made the kind of impact that she believed she had. And in fact, in some cases, she had had the reverse effect, or was being accused of that anyway.
So yeah, I just think it's a truly great comedy.
All right. Next week on the podcast, we'll be returning to Dorothy McGuire. It's going to be part 12 of our Actorist Oeuvre Review, Susan Slade, and Summer Magic. See you then.